Welcome back, students. In this lecture, we'll be doing a few numerical problems in the chapter of lasers. It's the fifth chapter from unit 3. We have covered up all the theory in the previous lectures, and in this lecture, we'll be only doing some numerical problems. So let's start. The first problem, the transition to the ground state from the upper and lower energy states in a laser system results in emission of photons of wavelength 6392 Armstrong units and 6438 Armstrong units respectively. Determine the ratio of opposition of the energy levels at 27 degrees Celsius. Also estimate the energy values of two levels in electron volts. So now what is this problem talking about? We have over here two energy levels, upper and lower energy levels, and from these energy levels there are transitions occurring to the ground state. So if I just draw them here, this we'll call it upper energy level, we'll call it as E2, lower energy level we'll call it as E1. So E1 and E2 are the lower and upper energy levels, and from these energy levels there are transitions which are occurring to the ground state. Let us say this is the ground state. So what is happening? Transition from E1 to ground state results in emission of photons having wavelength 6392 and 6438. So from lower to the ground state is, we'll call it as lambda 1, whereas from here to here, transition from here to here will give rise to a photon wavelength lambda 2. Now lambda 1 and lambda 2 values are given to us. So what is lambda 2 value? From the upper to the ground state, from the upper to the ground state is this first value, 6392. So this is lambda 2, 6392 Armstrong units, whereas from the lower to the ground state is the second value which is given to us, which is 6438 Armstrong units. Okay, so how do we know which one is of which? Remember, E2 to ground state is a higher energy difference. It's a bigger arrow, you can see. The arrow is bigger in size, so it involves more energy. More energy means lesser wavelength. Wavelength and energy are inversely proportional to each other. What is the formula which connects wavelength and energy? We have the formula for energy for photon as E is equal to h nu. In terms of wavelength, we can write this as hc by lambda. Nu is c by lambda, because lambda into nu is c. Velocity of light c is a product of frequency and wavelength. So therefore, frequency nu can be written as c by lambda. Okay, so I'll just write it over here. C is equal to lambda into nu. Product of frequency and wavelength gives you velocity. So from this, nu is equal to c by lambda. So what we have done there, over here the value of nu we have substituted as c by lambda. That's how we got this formula as E is equal to hc by lambda. So this is, you can see from this relation, therefore that energy and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other. E is equal to hc by lambda. Lambda comes in the denominator, so they are inversely proportional. So therefore, higher the energy means lesser wavelength. You can see here E2 to ground state involves a higher energy, so the lesser wavelength among the two wavelengths which are given to us, 6392 and 6438, 6392 is a lesser value, so more energy is assigned to the lesser wavelength. E1 to ground state, from here to ground state, lesser energy is involved. So lesser energy means higher wavelength. So among the two wavelengths, higher one is allotted to the lesser energy transition. So that's how we can find out which wavelength is of which. Okay. Now, what else is given to us? We have to now determine what is the ratio of opposition. So how many atoms are there in this level? How many atoms are there in this level? What is the ratio of opposition in the levels E2 and E1? So basically we have to determine this thing, N2 by N1. Okay? N2 by N1. So it's called as the ratio of opposition of the two energy levels E2 and E1. And we have a formula for this. While discussing about the population inversion, we had written down a formula for this. The formula for this is N2 by N1 is equal to E raised to minus of E2 minus E1 divided by K2. This entire thing is the exponential, okay? E raised to the entire thing, E2 minus E1 on KT. Now what is E2 and E1? E2 and E1 are the energy values of the two levels. E to any one. So we have to find out those values based on this formula. So based on this formula, E is equal to hc by lambda. We have to find the value of E1 and we have to find the value of E2 and then put it in formula. K is the Boltzmann constant, 1.38 into 10 raised to power minus 23 Boltzmann constant K. And T is the temperature in Kelvin. So temperature is given to us as 27 degrees Celsius. So this is equal to 27 plus 273 will come out to be 300. Okay, so 300 Kelvin. So this is the value of temperature we have to substitute over here. So before we use this equation now, we are first going to find the values of E1 and E2 using this formula. So what's the formula? So what will be E1? E1 will be hc by lambda 1. Remember, h and c are constants. H is the Planck's constant, c is the velocity of light. The only variable in this thing is lambda. So for E1, it will be hc by lambda 1. So this will be, now what's the value of Planck's constant? 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34. Value of velocity of light, c is 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by lambda 1 value is 6438 into 10 raised to power minus 10. Why do we write it 10 to minus 10? Because it's given in Armstrong units. We are solving this problem in SI units. So conversion from Armstrong to meters is 6438 into 10 raised to power minus 10. And what does this come out to be? This value will come out to be 3.09 into 10 raised to power minus 19 joules. Remember, since we have solved this problem in SI units, we get the energy value also in SI units, which is joules. Similarly, we can find value of E2 also. E2 is hc upon lambda 2 it will become. So this again is 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by lambda 2 value is 6392. Armstrong units, need to convert it into meters by multiplying 10 raised to power minus 10. And this value will come out 3.11 into 10 raised to power minus 19. Again, this is in joules. So we got the values of E1 and we got the value of E2. We now need to put this thing in this equation to find the value of N2 by N1. So let's find that. So N2 by N1 is equal to E raised to minus of E2 minus E1 upon KT. So let's put the values now. So this will come E raised to minus of E2 was value 3.11 into 10 raised to power minus 19 minus 09 into 10 raised to power minus 19. This is the value of E1 divided by KT. K is 1.38 into 10 raised to power minus 23, and the value of T is 300 Kelvin. Okay, so this is this entire thing in the exponential you have to find. Now how do we find this e raised to on the calculator? You have to use shift and ln, natural logarithm. Natural logarithm, you have to do shift and then press n button and then type this entire thing, 3.11 10 raised to power minus 19, and then this entire thing on the scientific calculator you'll have to type it out. And if you have done everything properly, you should get the answer 0.616. So please take a scientific calculator and put in these values, shift ln and then minus 3.11 10 to the power minus 19, and this entire thing with proper brackets if you put, this is the answer you must get. So if you get this answer, it means that you have entered all your values correctly on your calculator. If not, you please try and learn how to properly enter these values on your scientific calculator. So we have got the first part of the problem answer, ratio of population. We are required to find the ratio of population N2 by N1. So we have found the ratio of the population in the level E2 to the level E1. Now also there is a small further part in this problem. It is asking us to find the energy values of the two levels in electron volts. Please note, we have already found the energy values, but we have got the values in joules. these two values of E1 and E2. We have got them already, but the values are in joules. All they ask is to convert this joules value into electron volts. Now what's the conversion factor? To convert from joules to electron volts, the conversion factor is, you have to multiply with, you have to divide with E. You have to divide a value in joules by E. Where what is E? E is the charge of the electron, 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 90 coulomb. So if you divide this value in joules by 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19, you will get the answer in electron volts. So we will see that we have E1. E1 is 3.09 10 to the power minus 19. So I will convert this into joules, electron volts, sorry. So E1 is 3.09 into 10 raised to the power minus 19. This is in joules. So to convert it into electron volts, I have to divide this value by 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19. And if you divide this, you will get the answer as 1.93. You can check it out. Divide 3.09 into 10 to the power minus 19 by 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19. The answer will come out to be this much, and the answer is in electron volts. Similarly, E2 value, which we already have calculated, is 3.11 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 joules. Again, this value, if you divide by 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19, you will get the answer as 1.94, and this answer is in electron volts. So these are the two values of the energy levels in electron volts. So that's the full solution to the problem. Next problem, determine the ratio of population of two energy levels, out of which one corresponds to a metastable state if the wavelength of light emitted at 57 degrees Celsius is 6328. So again, it's the same type of problem. We have to find and determine the ratio of population, so N2 by N1. So what's the formula for N2 by N1? N2 by N1, there's no square there. So this is N2 by N1. What is it equal to? The formula is the same which we had earlier. It is E raised to minus of E2 minus E1 divided by KT. Now here temperature is given to us as 57 degrees Celsius, so which is equal to, in Kelvin, you have to add 273. So if you add 273 to 57, I think you'll get the answer as 330 Kelvin. Okay, so that's the value of temperature. So now all we need to find is the value of E2 and the value of E1. But now in this problem, only one wavelength is given to us. In the previous problem, if you had seen, the two values of wavelength were given to us. From that, we could find the value of E1, we could find the value of E2. But here now only one wavelength is given. So basically, what is this problem talking about? The two energy levels, E2 and E1. And the transition is not occurring to the ground state, but the transition is occurring here between themselves. From E2 to E1, the transition is occurring. So there's no ground state which is involved in this particular problem. So the transition is only from E2 to E1. And what photon does it give out over here? It gives out a photon of wavelength lambda equal to 6328 Armstrong units. So therefore, if you remember, whenever a transition occurs between the level E2 and E1, how much is the energy and photon energy which is given out? Photon energy is H nu is equal to E2 minus E1. Whenever a transition occurs between two energy levels, the photon which is given out has an energy exactly equal to the difference between the two levels, which is, how much is the difference? E2 is upper level, E1 is the lower level, so the difference between the two levels is E2 minus E1. So this E2 minus E1 is converted into a photon. Photon, what's the energy of a photon? H nu. So therefore we can write that H nu, energy of photon, is equal to the difference between the two energy levels, E2 minus E1. So using this relation then, we can find not E1 and E2 separately, but we can find the entire quantity E2 minus E1. So again, you can substitute nu over there. So we can write as HC by lambda is equal to E2 minus E1. Now, lambda value is given to us, 6328. If you put it over here and put the values of H and C, we will get this entire quantity. We will get this entire quantity E2 minus E1. We won't get E1 and E2 separately, but we will get them as one full term. And that's what is all required over there. In the formula, it's E2 minus E1. Even if we do not know the values of E1 and E2 separately, If you know the value of E2 minus E1, you can directly put it in that formula and calculate the value of N2 by N1. So let's first calculate this quantity, E2 minus E1. So what is E2 minus E1 from this formula which I have written over there? E2 minus E1 is HC by lambda. So this is equal to 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by lambda is given as 6328 into 10 raised to power minus 10. You need to convert it into meters, SI units. This answer, I think, comes, you can check it on your calculator. It comes out to be 3.14 into 10 raised to power minus 19 joules. Now, all you have to do is put this value in the above formula, in this formula here, and you will get the value of N2 by N1. So N2 by N1 is equal to e raised to all that thing. So it is e raised to minus of E2 minus E1, the entire value we know, it is 3.14 into 10 raised to power minus 19 divided by K is 1.38 into 10 raised to power minus 23, and the value of T is 330. Okay, so this answer, again using a calculator, you press shift ln and then minus 3.14 10 raised to power minus 19 divided by, see that you put proper brackets for this part here because this entire thing is a denominator, 1.3 10 raised to power minus 20 into 330. So entire thing, if you properly input in your calculator, you'll get the answer as 1.13 into 10 raised to power minus 30. Okay. Now please note, this doesn't have any units. Okay? It's a ratio of two numbers. N2 is the number of atoms in the upper level, N1 is the number of atoms in the lower level. So the ratio doesn't have any units, it's just a simple number. So 1.13 10 raised to power minus 30. So this is the ratio of the population of the two energy levels. That was what was asked in the problem. On the next problem, a laser is characterized by certain energy levels where the ratio of population of the two energy levels is, now here ratio of population is already given to us. Ratio of population is given to us, out of which the upper level corresponds to a metastable state. Determine the wavelength of light emitted at 57 degrees Celsius. So in this problem, ratio of population is given to us. We are required to find the wavelength. In the previous problem, what was there? The wavelength was given to us. We were required to find the ratio of population. So this problem is the same formula you'll have to use, but you'll have to work the reverse way. Why? Here, because ratio of population is given to us, we require to find the wavelength. Temperature is also given to us. So the same formula is involved here, but you have to work it out in the reverse direction. N2 by N1 is equal to e raised to minus of E2 minus E1 upon KT. So same formula, but this time now N2 by N1 value is known to us. It's 1.132 into 10 raised to power minus 28. E2 minus E1 value you will have to calculate from this formula, and then we will have to use this formula later on. E2 minus E1 is equal to HC by lambda. So once you get value of E2 minus E1 from this formula, the first formula here, then whatever E2 minus E1 you get, you put it in this second formula here and then put calculate the value of lambda. So we'll first need to find the value of E2 minus E1 from the formula N2 by N1. Now how will we do that? You can directly put the value of N2 by N1 and solve it, but it will be slightly more simpler if you take log on both sides, so that the exponential term will go, e raised to term will go, if you take natural logarithms on both sides. So if for this equation what I'll do is, I take ln N2 by N1 is equal to ln e raised to minus of E2 minus E1 by KT. So I applied natural logarithm on both sides of the equation. Now if you remember the formula of properties of logarithm, ln of e raised to x is x. Okay? So ln, once again, ln e raised to x using this property of logarithms, we can write this as equal to just minus of E2 minus E1 upon KT. So what is X? This entire term over here is your X. Okay, so ln of E raised to X is X. So minus of E2 minus E1 upon KT. So now from this, what is E2 minus E1 then? We have ln of N2 by N1 is minus of E2 minus E1 upon KT. So we are interested in finding the value of E2 minus E1. So in the value of E2 minus E1, so KT you have cross multiplied and take it that side, and so it will become minus of ln N2 by N1 into KT. So this is the formula for by which you can get the value of E2 minus E1. So let's put and get the value. So this is minus of ln of what value of N2 by N1, it is 1.132 into 10 raised to the power minus 28 into K value is 1.38 into 10 raised to the power minus 23. Temperature is 57 degrees Celsius, which is equal to again 330 Kelvin. So into 330. So what will this come out to be? You can work it out on the calculator. The answer will come out to be 2.93 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 joules. Because we have solved the problem in SI units, we get answer as joules. Now, what do we need to do? We need to put this value of E2 minus E1 over here. Okay, in this place and calculate the value of lambda. So let's do that. So we have this equation, E2 minus E1 is equal to hc by lambda. So from this, what is lambda then? Lambda will be hc divided by E2 minus E1. So what will this be? 6.63 into 10 raised to the power minus 34 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by E2 minus E1. The value was here, it's the value 2.93 10 raised to the power minus 19. This will be your final answer. What will the answer will come out as 6.788 into 10 raised to the power minus 7. You can do this on your calculator and check. This is the answer you get. Now, what will be the units of this? You're calculating wavelength. So wavelength is a length, some type of length it is. So its answer will be SI units will be meters. Length is measured in meters. But normally write wavelength in Armstrong units, because if you remember, see most of the problems say the values of lambda were mostly given in Armstrong units. So it is always better to convert wavelength into Armstrong units. So how do we convert this? Remember, one Armstrong unit is 10 raised to power minus 10 meters. So we already have 10 raised to minus 7. We have to make this as 10 raised to minus 10. So for that, I can write this as 6788 into 10 raised to power minus 10 meters. What I have done? I have shifted a decimal place from here, 3 places forward, 1, 2, 3. So from 6.788, I have made it as 6788. So 3 decimal places when I shift towards the right, from minus 7 it becomes minus 10. And then, what is this part? 10 raised to the power minus 10 is nothing but 1 Armstrong unit. So I can write this as 6788 Armstrong units. So this is your answer in Armstrong units. You can anyway stop with this answer itself, not required to convert into Armstrong units. But in case it's asked in the problem, then you'll have to do this conversion. We'll do one last problem in this chapter. The mode separation of 2 milliwatts helium neon laser operating at 6,328 Armstrong units is 1,500 megahertz. Megahertz. H is capital. What must be the length of the laser cavity to ensure that only one longitudinal mode oscillates? How many photons will be emitted by the laser in 1 second? Okay, so now this is a problem related to the optical resonator. Okay, if you remember, the length of optical resonator was required to satisfy the certain condition. Okay, only when standing waves are formed between the two mirrors of the optical resonator, only then light can be amplified. So that the standing wave will be formed only when length between the mirrors, the two mirrors of the optical resonator, this length L needed to satisfy some certain condition n lambda by 2. Only when this condition was satisfied, the standing waves could be formed. If you then further read the further part, we had derived, obtained a formula for what is called as modal frequency. What is that formula? So this is a formula for the modal frequency. If you can refer to the section of optical resonator, longitudinal cavity modes. Just after the construction of the optical resonator, we had further discussed a topic called as longitudinal cavity modes, wherein we had talked about this standing wave forming between the two mirrors of the optical resonator. And then we had obtained this formula for modal frequency as nu m equal to mc by 2l. Here m is the order number, modal number, m is modal number or just simply order, and n was the length between the two mirrors, length of the optical resonator. So from this we are required to find what? We are required to find length. What must be the length? So L we must find out. So from this L is equal to mc by 2 nu m. So what is the value of m you are going to put? What is the modal number? What is it said over here? To ensure that only one longitudinal mode vibrates, only one. So modal number, so is 1. If you were to say ensure only two longitudinal mode vibrates, then m value would have been 2. So since it is mentioned 1 over here, m value you have to take it as 1. So this will be equal to 1 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 divided by 2 into, now what is the modal frequency given to us? So the mode separation, please note another word for modal frequency is mode separation. Okay, so mode separation and modal frequency mean the same thing. So modal frequency is given to us as 1500 megahertz. So nu m is 1500 megahertz. So 1500 into 10 raised to 6 mega. Mega means 10 raised to 6. So what does this answer come out to be? This will be, if you check it on the calculator, it will be 0.1 meter. Please note, since you have solved this problem in SI units, the answer also comes out in SI units, which is meter. So 0.1 meter. How many centimeters is that? This 0.1 meter is 10 centimeter. So basically the distance between these two mirrors of optical resonator L for obtaining only one longitudinal mode of vibration, L must be kept as 10 centimeter or 0.1 meter. So this is how we can calculate the length between the mirrors required for whatever mode of vibration you want, whatever frequency, whatever wavelength of laser you want. You can adjust it by adjusting the length between the two mirrors. So 0.1 meter length for only one longitudinal mode of vibration. Now, next part of the problem, you also need to calculate how many photons are emitted from the laser in 1 second. So once you switch on the laser, how many photons are coming out every second from the laser system? How do we find that? We are going to use the formula for power. Power of a laser, power is normally work done upon time. Okay, but this formula for power, work done upon time, is only applicable for machines where actual work is done. For a laser system, the laser doesn't do any mechanical work, but it gives out, it does work in the form of giving out light energy. So it gives out energy. So for any light emitting source, its power is given as the energy it emits per unit time. So energy upon time. So instead of work upon time, the formula for power for any light source, light emitting source, is energy it emits per unit time. Now, a laser emits light in the form of photons. So let's say it emits n photons, n number of photons. So let's say it emits n photons. So what will be the total energy it is emitting? One photon has an energy h nu. Each photon has an energy h nu. So if n photons are being emitted, the total energy emitted by the laser will be n times h nu. So n, E I can write as n times h nu divided by time. Further, now in the problem here, the frequency of the laser is not given. The wavelength of the laser is given to us, this value. Please note, this frequency is not the frequency of the laser. 1500 megahertz is the modal frequency that is only applicable to the optical resonator. What is the actual color or what is the actual wavelength or frequency of the light which is emitted is this. 6328. It's a red color laser. 6328 is a red color laser. So the wavelength of the laser is given to us. Whereas in this formula here, we have frequency. So we can convert this into a wavelength as m into h c by lambda on t. So what I have done, frequency nu, I have replaced it by c by lambda. So this n formula finally becomes n h c upon lambda t. Okay, n h c upon lambda t. So we have p is equal to n h c upon lambda t. Our aim is to find what? How many photons? N. We have to find n, number of photons which is emitting. From this, what is n equal to? We have p is equal to n h c upon t. So n will come p into lambda into t divided by h c. Okay, this is the formula for your n, number of photons. Now, power is given to us as 2 milliwatts. So 2 into 10 raised to power minus 3, milli stands for 10 raised to power minus 3. Wavelength 6328 angstrom units, so 6328 into 10 raised to power minus 10. Now, time is much. It is number of photons emitted in 1 second. So every second how many photons emitted we need to find out. So time is 1 divided by h is 6.63 into 10 raised to power minus 34 and c is 3 into 10 raised to 8. So this, if you calculate, it will come out to be 6.36 into 10 raised to power 15. So again, this doesn't have any units. It is just a number. How many photons? This many number of photons are emitted per second. It doesn't have any units. So you see, it's a very large number, 10 raised to 15. And this number of photons are emitted in just 1 second. And this is just a 2 milliwatt laser. It's a very low power laser. So even a low power laser emits a huge number of photons every second. Okay. So and all this, you remember how it starts. It just starts one photon, stimulated emission. One photon gives rise to two photons, those two further give rise to 4, then 8, then 16, and then finally such a large number within a very small amount of time. It doesn't take hours for the laser to come out. The moment you press the button of the laser, immediately it gives out the laser light. Okay? And all this process from one photon to this many large number of photons occurs in a very, very, very small amount of time. So it occurs in milliseconds. You can hardly make out the time by the time you switch on the button. Already the light is out. Okay, so always remember, the number of photons emitted in any laser system are very large. That's why the intensity of a laser is very high. Okay, so with this we end the problems in this chapter of lasers.